I'm Erica Zavaleta, and this is Ecosystems of California. We're at Fort Ord Reserve today, part of the UC Santa Cruz Natural Reserve System, and we're visiting a maritime chaparral ecosystem. Chaparral comes in a huge diversity of forms because it occurs through so much of California. Maritime chaparral is different from what we visited at Jasper Ridge because it's not defined by its dominant species. The chamois define the chaparral system at Jasper Ridge. Here, the system's defined by climate on the one hand because fog is providing moisture in an unusual form throughout most of the year, and also by its soils. This is an old dune system, so we've got sandy soils, low in nutrients, pretty fast draining, and those sandy soils also shape features like the structure of the vegetation. Sand mat manzanita is this low-growing endemic Arctostaphylos or manzanita species, and its growth form reflects the soils that it's occurring on. Gage Dayton is the director of the UC Santa Cruz Natural Reserve System, and he's here with us at Fort Ord Reserve to show us a little bit more about this maritime chaparral ecosystem.
Yeah, so my name is Gage Dayton, and I work at UC Santa Cruz, and we're at the Fort Ord Natural Reserve, which is part of the University of California Santa Cruz Natural Reserve System. And this reserve is an example of coastal maritime chaparral, which is a plant community that's dominated by manzanita species, Arctostaphylos. And the primary species that's really unique in this maritime chaparral community is the Arctostaphylos pumila, the sand mat manzanita, which is all throughout this area. And this is an example of that plant right here. It'll actually shoot roots out from the branches and grow in this kind of lateral growth form, this habit. And this is a real unique plant species. And then if we look over in this area, what we see in here is this open sandy area. And this is where you have a lot of these rare annual plants. They come into this open sandy area and persist. And again, this time of year, it's a little late, but you can see this is actually Monterey spinefowl, which is a federally listed species. And it really depends on these open sandy areas. So again, if you think back to that disturbance, thinking about disturbance and thinking about fire in this area, if you can imagine right after a fire, this whole area was sand. And then a lot of these annuals come in, they live just for a year, and you get a very ephemeral plant community that exists in this area. Then over time, you have Arctostaphylos, like the Arctostaphylos pumila, the sand mat manzanita, that comes in and it's adapted to fire. So this particular species actually produces seeds, and the plants grow from seeds. Some Arctostaphylos are sprouters, which they sprout from the burl, but this one will burn and then sprout from seeds. So now, if you think about post-fire, as that time moves on and you kind of move through the successional stage, and some of the sandy area goes away. Okay, so I don't know when the last fire here was, and that's a big deal for maritime chaparral and chaparral communities in general, is what is a natural fire regime? Is it 30 years? Is it 40 years? Is it 10 years? Is it 15 years? Is it 200 years? And so one of the things we're doing here at the Fort Ord Natural Reserve is trying to figure out how old this community is. And we don't know that right now. We know that it hasn't had a big catastrophic fire in the last 80 years, but likely much longer than that. Well over 100 years would be my guess. So now if we look around this landscape over here, what we see is, again, thinking about right after that catastrophic event, let's just say it was 200 years ago, we had sand, and now we fast forward and this community is 200 years old. Again, this is hypothetical. But if you look around, what you can see is when we look at a plant community, we think of it as very static because we're looking at it, plants aren't running around, they're not moving, they're not jumping, they're easy to grab, they're easy to catch. And the typical thing to do is think, well, this is a static system and it's looked like this for a long time. But if you look for clues in the environment, you can actually get a feel for how dynamic this community is and how it's changed over time. Okay, now remember, we're thinking about the major disturbance factor being fire, which is a big disturbance factor that comes in and it'll burn down this community and restart. But another thing, another disturbance mechanism are animals, browsers and grazers. And these animals, will eat vegetation and reduce growth or eliminate individuals from growing in particular areas. So now if in this area you see the Arctostaphylos pumila, but right over here, this, which looks like an Arctostaphylos pumila, is actually a coastal live oak. That's an oak tree. And if you look down close at the branches, what you'll see is a pattern that is consistent throughout this area, and they're real short internodes, meaning it kind of looks like a chia pet, right? Real short growth. And these branches have been browsed off by deer. So the deer are coming in and eating away at the coast live oak. They like to eat live oak. They like to eat another plant that's called ceanothus, but they don't like to eat the sandmat manzanita, and they don't like to walk through it. And so what you can see here is that the oak is back in the sandmat manzanita, but the deer can still get here and chew away at it and eat it. And so they're really reducing the growth rate of this this individual oak. So if we look around again, you can see another live oak. Now this live oak's only about 2 feet tall, but it could be 30 or 40 years old. We have no idea how old it is, but it's very stunted by the deer. There's another coast live oak over there. And again, if you're just walking through this with your blinders on, you might think that that was Arctostaphylos pumila, the sandmat manzanita, but it's actually coast live oaks. So the deer are really playing an important role in slowing down that succession. Now let's fast forward. Let's just imagine that this bush was here. The sandmat manzanita grows out. The deer don't like to walk through the manzanita for whatever reason. So let's just pretend we're fast forwarding, say 50 or 100 years. You get a situation like this, where you have now an oak tree that has grown up and it's starting to outcompete for light the sandmat manzanita. And what you see is this oak tree eventually escaped the herbivory from the deer, shot up a runner, and now it's going. And as soon as it escapes from the herbivory, it grows and starts killing back this manzanita. And that is called a nurse plant effect. So the manzanita provides a safe refuge for the live oak, which then grows up and kills its nurse, the nurse plant. And you can see this ring of death around the below the oak. And what you have is a lot of organic material falling in. So these soils are real low in nutrients, but as an oak gets established, it drops leaves and changes the soil composition under the trees, which is really remarkable. And now let's fast forward maybe another 100 years or so and look over here. This now you can see is maybe a 200-year-old oak, and they're dying, and for various reasons. We've had drought, but disease and whatnot also will kill oaks. But you can see the effect of this oak tree. Probably there was manzanita underneath it, but now there's nothing underneath it and the oak's growing. But what you do see is that there is this residual effect of that oak on the community. So there's very little actually growing under the oak. And why is that? We don't know for sure, but it could be because that soil composition has really changed. And so now, if you zoom out into this area and look at it, and again, thinking about how the environment is very dynamic, and going back to our right after our fire from when this was just sand, hypothetically 200 years ago, now to 200 years post-fire, you look around and all the oak trees, at the base of all the oak trees, you can see the manzanita that used to be there that essentially provided that nurse plant effect for the oak trees as they grew up. And so what are we standing in? As Erica mentioned, this is a maritime chaparral community, but really we're looking at perhaps a young oak forest right here. And so really it's your perspective on time post-disturbance. And now that in these areas where we have really long fire intervals or fire has been controlled, we're changing the community. And then the role that herbivores play on reducing or slowing down that successional rate is really dramatic and something that we're learning a lot about here at the Fort Ord Natural Reserve.
It's really easy for us to see the plants in a system. Just like Gage was saying, the plants are here all day long. They're big, they're not moving. But we want to understand what's going on with the animals in a system too. And throughout California, you should be asking yourself at least two basic questions. Who's here in terms of animals? And what are they doing? How are they shaping the ecosystem in various ways to make it look different than it would look if there weren't animals in it? To answer those questions, we have to do more than just walk around, because a lot of the animals that live in these systems are nocturnal, they're secretive, they're mobile, and they're avoiding us. And so some of what we're going to do today is have a look at some different ways that we can answer those two questions. Who's here, and how are they shaping the ecosystem? Chaparral animals include a lot of small mammals, things like kangaroo rats, wood rats, and different kinds of mice. And even though they're small, they can have a big impact on the shape of the ecosystem in a couple of ways. One is that they can consume a lot of herbaceous vegetation, so they can eat grasses and wildflowers and some of the annual plants, especially right near the shrubs that they're hiding in, and clear those areas of ground. We saw that at Jasper Ridge in those cleared areas around some of the shrubs. Another thing they can do is that many of them eat seeds, and so they can favor the plants that they don't really prefer to eat, and they can reduce populations and abundance of the plants whose seeds they really like to eat. Paradoxically, if you have small mammals that are called scatter hoarders, that are collecting seeds and burying them, they can really help those species out. By burying those seeds and then often forgetting that they're there or leaving them there, what they can do is they can disperse seeds from some of these species, and they can bury them deep enough that even when a stand replacing fire comes through, those seeds are deep enough to avoid the lethal impacts of the heat and then to resprout better than the seeds that are burned at the surface of the soil. One way to get the measure of small animals in an ecosystem like this is to systematically capture them and then let them go once we've recorded who we caught, what size they are, and so on, and then possibly also marking them in some way so that we can use mark recapture methods later on to see whether we've recaptured the same individuals and what proportion they make up of the recaptures, and use that to estimate population size. Now, this is something you can't do on your own. You need a number of permits to actually trap these animals live, but Gage has been doing this for a long time, and so he can show us how this works here at Fort Ord Reserve. So here's a trap that Gage set last night, and we're going to check it.
Yeah, so this is called a Sherman live trap, and they function by having a trap door. We'll look, and in each trap we put in bedding for the animal to keep it warm, and then we bait it with, in this case, oats. You can use different types of bait for different species or different areas. And this is, there's somebody in here. We'll shake him out. And this is a Paramiscus boilei, which is a California brush mouse. The generic name is deer mice, and there's different types of deer mice. This is the brush mouse, Paramiscus boilei. So we'll get in here, and you can scruff them, take different measurements if you're depending on what your question is. For our work here, we're just interested in the species composition of this area. So we have traps set out, and we'll trap here throughout the year and catch animals and identify them and let them go. Often we're not going to mark them today, but as Erica mentioned, you can put a little ear tag in their ear, and that gives them a unique identification. And so you know when you've got a recapture, and that then you can actually count the number of individuals. If you don't tag them, you can only get relative abundance. So again, a little Paramiscus boilei. One of about seven species of small mammals here. So another important animal in this ecosystem is a wood rat, Neotoma fusites. They play an important role by grazing on vegetation. They primarily eat green vegetation, twigs, leaves, what have you. And they also, one of their distinctive characteristics about the wood rat is its nest. And you can see over here we have a nest that's about 3 or 4 feet tall, probably 4 foot in diameter. And that nest is built of sticks that the wood rat has gathered over time. And the wood rats will pass the nest down for multiple generations. And they are typically under oak trees. However, they're also found within thick manzanita. And the wood rats themselves will actually browse on manzanita and oaks for food, but then also to keep passageways so that they can move through the areas. So So we put these traps out. All the animals that we're trapping here are nocturnal. So we typically put the traps out the night before and we'll bait them with the oats and the bedding, and then they'll stay open overnight, and then we come back in the morning to check them. We check them before it gets too hot so the animals aren't too stressed. And you can see that we're under this oak woodland right now, and there's a wood rat nest right here. You can see actually there's very little vegetation on it. There's real clear and good examples of entrances into the wood rat nest. And we put a trap right here thinking that we might catch a wood rat. And there's definitely something in this trap. And often when you come up to a trap, the first thing you look to see is if the door's shut. And then you can, second thing is how heavy is it? And this one is pretty heavy. So. And wood rats are much bigger than the paramiscus that we saw earlier. And so you have to be careful when you're getting them out. And wood rats are notorious for being somewhat feisty. So let's see if we can get this guy out. So this is the wood rat. He's a major player in this ecosystem. They are herbivores, grazers, they eat browse vegetation, but then they also are a major food source for owls and snakes and other animals. And as I mentioned, they're feisty and they're also very vocal. For whatever reason, wood rats are more vocal than many of the other species that we capture. And they bite. They can bite kind of hard. We're not hurting it and bothering it, obviously. But it doesn't want to be handled, and I don't want to lose it before we have an opportunity to see it. And they also pee all over the place. A feisty, feisty animal. Yeah, I think what we'll do is we'll just take a look at it through the bag. You can see it's peed in the bag, and that's a defense mechanism. There it is. And you can see my hand. It's a relatively big animal. And then if we pan over here, we can look at its nest, and you can see these entrances. And we'll let it go right here. Again, we're not tagging these animals, and we'll see where it goes. My guess is it'll go down one of those holes. Whoop, there it went, into its nest. And you can see there's several entrances and exits. A couple down here, here, back in there. And it went into this hole, which then goes back down into a chamber. So you can see here, as we talked about earlier, we have a manzanita on the edge. And then this, again, is one of those oaks that's been really browsed down. But this, the animal that's browsing this, isn't a deer. A deer has browsed it over here towards the edge. And if you look closely on some of those other branches, you can see that the twigs have actually been pulled on. But this over here has actually been browsed probably partially by a deer, but then primarily by wood rats. And over underneath the oak, you can see the wood rat nests. But what the wood rats do is they come out and they actually create these holes in the shrubs where they can come underneath the shrub, make a hole, come out, and then run all over the top, eating the fresh leaves, and then taking twigs back to their nests. And one of the things that we talked about with the deer reducing or slowing down that succession on the oak trees, obviously the wood rats can too. But even on the older oak trees, for some reason, if it's a nest is right under an oak tree, you can actually see that wood rats will really focus in and hammer an individual tree. So if you look at this oak tree, it has that real short kind of chiapet growth on the terminal ends of the branches here, obviously way too far out of reach of a deer. So what's going on here is that the wood rats are actually running all over this oak tree and grazing it from above, or browsing it from above. And if you look closely at some of the branches on this oak tree, you can see that they're actually sheared off. The wood rats have a real clean cut when they're snipping branches. So you can think of it as kind of snipping them off, whereas a deer will actually pull and tear them off. So this oak tree obviously made it, started growing up pushing back the manzanita, once it escaped the browsing from the deer. But now the growth is being dramatically reduced, and this oak doesn't look like it's in very good condition, by intensive wood rat browsing all over the top of the tree.
Oh, here's a little guy. Okay, so we have a deer mouse, a Paramyniscus maniculatus.
This is one of the most widespread, if not the most, I think it's the most widespread small mammal in North America. It's all the way from Mexico, all the way up into Alaska and Canada. Paramyniscus maniculatus, it's a deer mouse. And they are, the distinguishing features, like the brush mouse that we saw earlier, it's in the same genus, but these guys have a tail that's shorter, about the size of their body, and very common, lots of different habitats, brush, forests, deserts, what have you. And this species also is the species that harbors hantavirus, which is an airborne virus that can kill you. Typically, people get that virus when they're breathing in feces that are shedding the virus in a confined space. So we're very careful when we hold Paramyniscus not to have the trap in our, shaking the trap in our mouth where we can breathe the virus in, and not to get bit by the animals or touch ourselves. But yeah, this is typically I think it's the smallest Paramyniscus in the genus, and the most widespread and common, and very common here on the Fort Ord Natural Reserve. Especially in these kind of scrubland habitats. And this area that we're sampling in now is a grassland that's transitioning into potentially an oak woodland. So about 40 years ago or so, this area was wide open. And these species, Paramyniscus, eat seeds primarily. They'll also eat bugs when the seeds are not abundant. So they'll eat insects and other invertebrates. And you can imagine they're not typically in grassland habitat, so as this community is transitioning into more of a shrubland or a forest, we're seeing species such as Paramyniscus maniculatus come into this area.
Hi.
Just south, kind of, yeah, we're south.
Gage also has a series of drift fences and pitfall traps out here. And these are to catch animals that, rather than climbing up and over these fences when they walk up to them, will follow them until they get to a buried bucket, which is the pitfall trap, and then fall in. So he can open these in the evening and then come back and check them in the morning to monitor for things like snakes, lizards, frogs and toads, and non-flying insects. He's also got a cover board here. The cover board is just a place that things might seek refuge underneath, so that, again, when you come out here in the morning, you can just flip up the board and see if anybody's home.
Okay, we're checking our pitfall traps right now, and these are set out to monitor primarily small vertebrates, but they also capture insects. That's just a little Jerusalem cricket. We have 20 pitfall arrays set up throughout the reserve here, and 5 in each of 4 different, the main habitat types that we have here. Oh, look, we caught a horned lizard. This is a Blainville's horned lizard, which is one of our relatively common species here on Fort Ord Natural Reserve, but they're kind of having a hard time. They're relatively rare throughout California. The horned lizards are ant specialists. They eat native ants. And one of the things that's going on with horned lizards throughout our region and then throughout California is the Argentine ant is coming in and invading and displacing the native ants, which is displacing the food source for these animals and having a real negative impact on the animals. The Argentine ants seem to be more localized around water sources, so you typically find them in urban and suburban areas rather than in dry areas like the interior of the Fort Ord Natural Reserve. So here on Fort Ord, these horned lizards are relatively common because the Argentine ants haven't infiltrated the entire reserve. Another reason why the horned lizards are relatively rare and having a hard time is because they're easy to catch. Their main defense is being cryptic, blending in, and so they'll move and stop. You can see on their back, they've got these modified scales that are prickly. On the backs of their head, they actually have horns. This one actually has, its horns are broken or reduced. But often as they get older, the horns will get much larger, which makes it not a very fun thing to swallow if you're a predator. However, cats, domestic cats, will often kill them too. So you have a combination of cats, habitat destruction, Argentine ants. And another thing is when they run and stop, they're easy to catch. And they're such a cool animal that people catch them and take them home for pets. But because they're ant specialists, they essentially starve to death and they don't make good pets. So those factors combined make the horned lizard a relatively rare species in California. It's a species of special concern. And unfortunately, my guess is that within the next 20 years or so, it'll probably be a listed species because those impacts or those factors that are having an impact on this species are continuing. And until something's done, these guys will probably have a reduced range over time. One of the things we talked about is the diet of the horned lizards and how they eat invertebrates, but they primarily eat ants. And the ant is a critical component of their diet. But those ants live in these open sandy areas in the Maritime Chaparral. And so as the community evolves and grows and changes and those sandy areas go away, so does the habitat for the horned lizard. So we just let this horned lizard go, and you can see their short, stubby legs aren't built for running fast, but their mottled back is very camouflaging. And so their main defense is, when they're startled, is to run and stop in the hope that whatever is chasing them doesn't see them, so they blend in.
So the pitfall traps and the live trapping give us a sense of who's here. They allow us to quantify the diversity, the abundances, and the distribution in different vegetation types and so on of the animals. When we want to get past that who's here to a systematic understanding of how they're shaping the system, we need to do more though. So we can anecdotally look at browse and things like that to get a sense for how deer or wood rats or other types of organisms are influencing the shape of this ecosystem. But to study it systematically, it turns out that a great way to see how animals are affecting the ecosystem is to see what happens when you exclude them from the system. And so I'm standing in the middle of a series of plots that have been followed for about 15 years by Professor Laurel Fox at UC Santa Cruz. And what she's done is she's compared control areas like this, so she's marked off this plot where all of the animals still have access, to areas where different kinds of animals have been fenced out. That gives us this picture of what the system would look like if those animals weren't there. In this control plot, you can see all of these typical signs of animal activity. There's all this bare area cleared by things like rabbits. You can see how heavily deer have continued to browse these shrubs, so that this ceanothus, for instance, it's got those really, really short branches characteristic of having been chewed back over and over again. When you look at a plot that deer have been excluded from for over a decade, it looks pretty different. Shrubs are taller, and you can see that although the bare areas around them still exist, rodents can still get in here, rabbits can still get in here, but the shrubs themselves look really different, even the same individual. Here's one ceanothus that is protected from deer in here, and it's grown to be, you know, a little over a meter tall. The same individual right here is continuing to be browsed by deer, and that's keeping it a lot shorter. And then you can look at the plots where both deer and rabbits have been excluded, like this plot over here, and you can see how you have tall shrubs that have escaped browsing, and then below them you have quite a bit more productivity because rabbits aren't constantly at that low ground level removing vegetation. So if you look out over the landscape just a little bit here, you can see some of these other plots and get a feel for how this system might look different if those animals were excluded from it. You can see how the plots have systematically, they have taller shrubs in them. There's one over there with a live oak in it that's been protected from browse, and so it's gotten pretty tall pretty quickly. And you know, it's pretty likely that if those animals weren't here, this wouldn't be a chaparral system for very long at all. It would transition to being more of a woodland where all of these things like the live oaks could escape browsing really quickly and really quickly take over a system that starts out very briefly with small, herbaceous, and low-lying shrub vegetation following a disturbance. Well, and that concludes our visit to the Maritime Chaparral Ecosystems at Fort Ord Reserve here. Thanks so much for having us, Gage.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks, Erica. That was fun.
Hopefully we'll get down here again soon.
Yeah, anytime.
Thanks. Uh-huh.